Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Greenest Branch, a novel of Germany's first female physician, by P.K. Adams, narrated by Elizabeth Wiley. Preface. There is a lively debate within the historical fiction community as to whether, as authors, we must strive for maximum accuracy or whether we are allowed artistic license in the service of a good story. I fall into the latter camp, within reasonable bounds. If the story is based on a real person's life, that life should be recognizable. However, novels are judged on their pacing and flow, both of which can be affected if, for example, the historical timeline calls for a large gap in the narrative. Therefore, I believe we are justified in modifying certain facts or dates to fit the story we are telling. That said, the reader deserves to know if we do that. I wanted to make The Greenest Branch as historically accurate as possible. However, reliable record of what Hildegard did from the time of her enclosure to about the age of 40 is scant. For her later life, which is the subject of the second book in the series, we have more solid historical evidence. Scholars can't even agree on how old she was when she was first sent to St. Disibod. Some claim as young as 8, others as old as 13. Most seem to accept that she spent around 30 years in a small convent with a handful of other women in an environment of great privations, according to the rules governing anchorite monasticism. I have always been skeptical of that. I cannot imagine that a young child, separated from her family and subjected to decades of what can only be described, at least based on our modern sensibilities, as psychological abuse, could re-emerge in her middle years as an accomplished physician, writer, musician, theologian, and a correspondent of bishops, popes, and even a Holy Roman Emperor. Clearly something happened during those years that allowed her intellect and creativity to develop. A dull existence in an isolated enclosure would have been too mentally devastating. The result of my skepticism is The Greenest Branch, in which I imagine what Hildegard's life may have been like after her arrival at St. Disibod. To do that, I permitted myself a few timeline liberties. Firstly, I made Hildegard slightly younger. In the book, she is born in 1104, rather than the more commonly accepted year of 1098. It helps the narrative flow more smoothly. For the same reason, I had Jutta von Sponheim die in the year 1124, rather than 1136, and I kept Archbishop Adalbert of Mainz in prison until 1117, although in reality he was released in 1115. That said, the main cast, Kuno, Hellinger, Jutta, Volmar, and Ricardis, were real people, even if some of the events involving them are fictionalized. Brother Wigbert's name is fictional, but the character is based on a real infirmarian at St. Disibod. Of the major characters, only Griselda is entirely fictional. Some people may be forgiven for wondering about the relevance of Hildegard's story to the modern reader. Her experience may, on the surface, appear distant from ours. But I would argue that although women's condition has improved significantly since the 12th century, many must still make the kinds of choices that men are not expected to make. This is especially the case when it comes to choosing between family and a career. While the romantic storyline involving Volmar and Hildegard is an invention, chronicles suggest that he was her lifelong friend, confidant, and secretary. In turn, she wrote about him as the man whom I had sought and found. This makes my take on their relationship less than far-fetched. Moreover, in the workplace, many women still feel that they have to prove themselves over and over to justify their participation. Often, especially at St. Disibod, Hildegard was the smartest person in the room, but it was only by diminishing herself and her abilities that she was able to gain and maintain a seat at the table. I had not set out to write The Greenest Branch to underscore these points, But as the story unfolded, I became increasingly convinced of these remarkable parallels. Throughout her life, Hildegard struggled with migraines, which in the Middle Ages were not recognized as a medical condition. It is well documented how physically debilitating those episodes were, and that has made me wonder about the nature of her religious visions. Her descriptions are uncannily similar to the auditory and visual hallucinations that accompany strong migraines. I am not a migraine sufferer myself, but I have spoken with people who are, and some described experiencing bursts of bright or shimmering light and even echoes or whisper-like sounds during episodes. While my book focuses on Hildegard's achievements as a physician, it is worth remembering that it was her visions and the theological commentaries she wrote in later life that earned her widespread recognition and acknowledgement. I chart a delicate course in the book with respect to whether these visions were real or a ploy to allow her to speak out and write. After all, aside from royal wives and daughters, the only medieval women whose stories or writings were recorded were those who claimed to have visionary experiences. It makes for an interesting, if counterfactual, debate, and I will leave it to the reader to decide for herself or himself what to think. Finally, a note on the title. Hildegard's creative spirit is perhaps most visible in the dozens of chants she composed, many of which contain at least some reference to nature, which she deeply loved and championed. The Greenest Branch is the title of one of her better-known chants, O Veridissima Virga. It conjures an image of something new, fresh, and prolific, much like Hildegard herself. 1. Bermersheim, Rhineland, September 1115. The night I learned that I would be leaving my family home, the sounds of talk and laughter took a long time to die down. Finally, a growing chorus of snores from the hall told me that the guests from Sponheim were asleep. But there was a murmur of voices close by, and a faint light was coming from behind the partition that separated my parents' bedchamber from ours. Despite the late hour and the warmth of the bed I shared with my two sisters and a brother, curiosity got the best of me, and I slipped out of it, stepping silently across the rush-covered floor. I pulled my nightgown closer about me, for the autumn night was chilly, and put my eye to a chink through which the light was seeping. On the other side, the hearth was burning low, the reflection of its flames dancing sluggishly on the walls. My parents, Mechtild and Hildebert, sat facing each other across it. Their voices were low, too, but they came clear and distinct through the crack in the wood. "She is still a child, husband, only 10 winters old." My mother's voice was sad.
"Almost 11," my father countered.
With sharp strokes, my mother pulled a comb through the long strands of her graying hair. Normally, during her nightly combing ritual, those strokes were slow and deliberate. After a lengthy silence, my father spoke again.
"Oblates enter monasteries at all ages. Some spend years there before they are old enough to begin their novitiate."
"You know as well as I do that it is not a common practice."
"The Count's offer to recommend Hildegard to his daughter's convent is not to be passed over lightly. Count Stefan von Sponheim and his wife Sophia, in whose honor our feast had been held, were old family friends, visiting Bermersheim on their way back from Speyer, where the Count had had a landholding dispute to settle. I had never met their daughter Jutta, but like everybody in the Rhineland, I knew of the famous beauty whose abrupt decision to take monastic vows had dashed the hopes of eligible bachelors from Trier to Mainz." Silence descended on the chamber, during which my mother gazed straight at her husband with her big blue eyes. "Like mine," everyone said. This often had an unnerving effect on him, and the clipped tone of his next words indicated that it was so this time, too. "Hildegard was pledged to the church on her birth."
"I know," she replied impatiently.
As their 10th offspring, I belonged to the church in accordance with a custom known as the tithe, a time-honored tradition that was a source of pride and prestige for families. So the question they disagreed on was not if I should enter the cloistered life, but rather when. The Count's offer is generous indeed, and there is no doubt that Jutta von Sponheim would be a fitting teacher to Hildegard. But you heard what Countess Sophia said. Their daughter founded the convent and took the veil when she was 18 years old, a grown woman.
That is because she had not shown signs of a deeper sensibility of spirit before then. But Hildegard,
shouldn't she be allowed to reach womanhood and take this step with full awareness? My mother interjected in a tone that showed she did not care to hear that argument again. We have been preparing her for it since she was born. She knows her destiny and will follow that path like the dutiful daughter she is. But to cut short her carefree days seems so harsh.
My father ignored the interruption.
Hildegard has shown signs of a holy vocation since that day in the chapel.
I knew the story well. In fact, I remembered it vividly, although it had happened when I was only 3 years old. One day I wandered into the family chapel out by the orchard and was dazed by the sunshine streaming through the narrow windows on both sides of the altar like two swords of light. It illuminated the wooden figures of the apostles that my grandfather had ordered at Worms many years before in honor of Pope Gregorius's reforming efforts. The brightness of that light caused my head to ache, but it also made me feel weightless, as if I were lifted off my feet like a feather in the wind. Apparently, I stayed there for hours as the entire household searched for me frantically. It was my father who finally found me, and it was to him that I described my strange sensations in my tremulous, childish voice. But there was one thing my family did not know about, a remembrance of a command, the meaning of which I did not understand at that time. Such reveries happened to me on several occasions after that, especially when sunlight flooded the dim interior of the chapel during Mass, and always ended in strong headaches that would send me to bed for days.
"It's a manifestation of the touch of the Holy Spirit." My father's voice rose enthusiastically, prompting my mother to bid him keep it down.
"They are just spells."
She rolled her eyes wearily.
"It is a gift.
Another 2 or 3 years would prepare her better for the rigors of the cloister."
"The best way to prepare for it is to leave this world behind and devote herself to the duties of the contemplative life," he added in a softer tone, perhaps sensing my mother's desire to hold on to her youngest child for as long as she could. "Hildegard will be happy, and the Abbey of St. Disibod is only a day's journey from here. She will be close, and we will feel it."
But my mother would have none of it.
"You like the prospect of a smaller endowment," she said accusingly. "You think that Jutta's anchorite ways and the humbleness of her convent will allow you to pay less to secure Hildegard's entry."
"That is not the reason," he protested. "Our daughter has a gift that it is our duty to nurture."
Then his tone became irritable.
"But there is nothing wrong with economizing. You don't care for it because it is not your responsibility to ensure the well-being of this household. But you know as well as I do that salt prices have been falling for the past 4 years, and we are not earning as much from the Altsoy mine as we used to. Meanwhile, the costs of educating Hugo at mines are higher than I expected, and the girls will reach marriageable age next year."
The draft was making my feet cold, so I crept back to bed to take comfort from the warmth of my siblings' sleeping bodies. Rorik turned over, and Clementia murmured softly in a dream. Then all was silent again. After a while, the light in the bedchamber went out, and I lay in the dark, listening to the screeching of mice in the rushes. Normally, this familiar sound would have put me to sleep, but not now. My head was filled with too many thoughts. Leaving the family home forever would be difficult. There was a chance, of course, that my mother would prevail and I would remain at Bermersheim a little longer, but it was not likely. I knew very well that when my father made up his mind, there was no changing it. Listening to the steady breathing next to me, I was sure that I would miss Rorik, although his chief entertainment those days consisted of chasing us with lizards and aiming them squarely down the collars of our frocks. I might even miss Clementia and Margaret, even though I found the pastimes that absorbed their entire attention boring. Unlike my sisters, I had no interest in sewing or embroidering amid giggly, half-whispered conversations about neighborhood weddings, and I was mystified as to how the ability to make one's chain stitch even and round would help attract a good husband. Instead, to their unending astonishment, I asked for reading lessons from our mother's Book of Hours, or helped in the vegetable garden, planting and weeding alongside the kitchen servants, heedless of the warnings that I would end up tanned like a peasant. What I would miss most was the forest surrounding Bermersheim, full of ancient oaks and chestnuts, and quivering with the droning of bumblebees, the song of the thrush, and the cuckoo's calls on warm summer afternoons, and also the times when I would climb to our nurse's loft to watch her sort and mix bunches of dried herbs for use in draughts or ointments. Uda was the niece of a healing woman who lived in the woods outside the village and from whom she had learned the best times to pick leaves and roots so they were swelled with juices at the height of their curative powers. Uda taught me to love and respect herbs, and it was in the heady atmosphere of her chamber, warm and rich-scented, that I had first begun to marvel at the unseen power that seemed to connect all things in nature, nourishing and sustaining them. I called it viriditas, after a word I had found in my mother's small gardening book. It means weed in Latin, but also greenness, vitality, and freshness, and it is the perfect way to describe the secret, life-giving force flowing through the world. The thought of leaving my beloved forest and Uda's loft behind filled me with deep sadness, and I felt two tears roll down my temples. Yet the prospect was also exciting. For one thing, abbeys ran schools. My brother Hugo had gone to one at Lorsch before moving to Mainz to train for priesthood at the great cathedral there. I had always envied him, and now I would study too. The thought gave me a shiver of anticipation. Also, the idea of traveling away from the village where I had been born, and which I had never left, save for one trip with my father to Bingen with a consignment of salt from Alzoy, seemed appealing. The occasional visitors to Bermersheim had brought news of the latest developments in the emperor's long-standing quarrel with the Pope, about who should have the right to name bishops, and of the emperor's expeditions to Italy while his dukes schemed against him at home. These tidings filled my imagination with castles and knights, like the raven-haired, dark-eyed Rudolf von Stade, with a battle scar on his cheek, who was part of Count von Sponheim's retinue, or the heroes of Uda's bedtime stories, Siegfried and Roland, who wooed princesses and vanquished enemies. The Abbey of St. Disibod would be no royal court, of course, but still I imagined it full of pilgrims and visitors, certainly busier than the sleepy valley of Bermersheim, with its ancient house and a cluster of peasant cottages hugging the small parish church. When considered that way, the prospect of moving to St. Disibod was quite intriguing, in fact. The crowing of the first rooster filled the air, and the eastern sky became a shade less dark through the shutters. Before long, the guests would be rising to take their leave and continue on to Sponheim. With the arrival of dawn, I felt the turmoil in my head subside, and the heaviness of sleep descend on me at long last. 2. November 1115. We moved slowly through the quiet countryside under an overcast early morning sky, my father riding at the head on a bay mare. His easy posture in the saddle betrayed his past as a crusader in the Holy Land before he retired to tend our ancestral land. Riding alongside him was my eldest brother, Hugo, who had come down from Mainz for the occasion of seeing me off to the convent of St. Disibod. My mother and I rode in a wagon pulled by two dappled gray cobs and hemmed by several chests, including a carved cedar box that my father had brought from the east and that contained my monastic dowry of 100 golden bezants. It was still 10 days to the Feast of St. Andreas, but the clean, sharp scent of winter already permeated the air. It had snowed a little in the last few days, the grayish patches melting over the shriveled autumn leaves as the winds turned milder again. Wrapped in a cloak, I observed the countryside with interest, especially when the thick forest parted to reveal a farm or a village. Most of these were small and made up of ramshackle huts with thin wisps of black smoke rising from their chimneys. Among these abodes, skinny pigs and scrawny dogs mingled with children playing in the mud. The hamlets showed none of the prosperity that surrounded Bermersheim, with its whitewashed cottages covered in thatched roofs and abutted by vegetable plots. My father threw coins as we passed by, followed by watchful eyes staring from weather-beaten faces, dark with the perpetual tan of those exposed to the sun and wind all their lives. In the early afternoon, we stopped at an inn, a solid-looking timber structure with a tall column of smoke issuing from a single chimney in the middle of the roof. A small house, probably belonging to the innkeeper's family, was attached to the back. Beyond the buildings, a small area of the forest had been cleared for pasture. As it was November, the sounds of its seasonal occupants were now coming from the nearby cowshed, which also apparently served as a chicken coop and a pigsty. The property had a modest but well-kept look. The innkeeper, a stocky, black-bearded man in his 30s, emerged to greet us and introduced himself as Burkhardt. He bowed as he invited us inside and shouted in the direction of the stables, from which a boy of about 16, also short and starting to sprout a similarly black beard, came out to take our horses. The establishment was neatly furnished with rough-hewn tables and benches. There was a sizable barrel of beer in one corner, while the center was occupied by a large hearth. A cheerful-looking matron, plump and brisk, came out from behind the counter and called the maid to set a table. I took off my cloak and went to the fire to warm my hands. I wore a new frock of fine brown wool. A short veil covered my hair, recently cut, in preparation for my new life. Instead of the thick braid that used to fall to my waist, ash-blonde strands were poking from under the veil, curling slightly. When the food was brought in, the matron was joined by a girl of about 10, whose gaze drifted toward me even as she helped carry the plates of boiled ham, pea soup, and bread. "Are you taking the child to the Abbey of St. Disibod, my lord?" the innkeeper's wife asked, as she set a jug of ale in front of my father.
"Indeed," he said, nodding proudly. "She was accepted as an oblate."
I noticed the young girl's eyes widen and her mouth open as if to ask a question, but her mother was already on the way back to the kitchen and beckoned her to follow. We attacked the meal with great appetite, but when wine and fruit pies arrived, I slipped out of the inn. A pale sun had come out, and I stood in the yard enjoying its light on my face, if not its warmth. After a while, amid the intermittent bleating and squealing coming from the barn, I heard soft footsteps squelching in the mud, and turned to find the innkeeper's daughter walking toward me with a bowl half full of grain. She seemed shy for a moment, then mustered her courage. "I'm Griselda. My name's Hildegard." As she continued to regard me silently, I asked, pointing to the bowl, "Are you off to feed the chickens?" The coop was in the opposite direction. "Yes," Griselda blushed as she realized that I had seen through her ruse. "I do that sometimes when Varin is busy." She pointed toward the barn, where a lanky, fair-haired boy, clearly a hired hand, was balancing a pitchfork heaped with hay. I nodded. I had sometimes accompanied my father and his steward as they inspected Bermersheim's estates and had seen peasants at work in the fields and with livestock. It was hard work, but I envied them the chance to be outdoors and observe nature as it went through its endless cycle of birth, growth, and decline. I had once asked to be shown how to milk a cow, but my father had responded that ladies did not do that sort of work. "What's an oblate?" Griselda asked, curiosity shone in her green eyes, which were made even more striking by the whiteness of her skin and her dark hair. She was stocky like her father and had a heart-shaped face with a sharp chin that gave her a determined look. "It means a gift to God," I replied. "Someone who lives in a convent until she becomes old enough to enter the novitiate, which is when she learns to be a nun," I added with an air of authority. Her eyes lit up. "My papa once took me to the market at Disibodenberg," she said. "It was a feast day, and there was a mass in the abbey church that all the townspeople went to, and we went with them. I still remember the bells and the singing and the incense." She flushed at the memory. "It was beautiful." A shiver ran down my spine. Suddenly, I could not wait to be there. "I wish I could become an oblate, too," Griselda said wistfully. "Then why don't you ask your father to take you there?" She looked sideways at the inn. "Papa says girls must help their parents with their work and care for them in their old age." I was mystified. I knew that parents cared for their children, but the other way around. I looked at Griselda, whose face darkened as she added, "He says my dowry will be barely enough to marry me off to the baker's son." She jerked her chin toward the forest, presumably in the direction of the baker's cottage, and set her jaw. "But I will never marry that oaf." I did not know what to respond to that, but Griselda's thoughts were already running along a new track. "It would be so nice to spend time with only girls." I felt a tinge of sympathy, realizing that the innkeeper's daughter must have had little female companionship apart from her mother. "There are monks at St. Disibod, too," I said, as if that were a consolation. Griselda shrugged her shoulders. "They have separate cloisters and do not mingle." That authoritative-sounding statement made me frown. Nobody had explained to me what life would be like at the Abbey, except that I would pray, work, and, this I had added myself, for it could not be otherwise, study with the other oblates and novices. The prospect of studying excited my imagination, conjuring an image of a vaulted schoolroom full of pupils. I was about to share it with my new acquaintance when the sound of voices coming from the doors of the inn signaled that it was time to continue the journey. My mother waved and I ran to her. Together we climbed onto the wagon. As it wobbled back toward the road, I waved to Griselda, who was still standing where I had left her, a look of envy and admiration on her face. I turned again just before we entered the forest, but she was gone. We traveled through the gray landscape, faintly illuminated by colorless sunshine, and the silence was broken only by the creaking of the wheels and the splash of the horse's hooves on the muddy ground. My father was dozing in the saddle, lulled by the gentle rocking movement and the ale with which he had washed down his meal. My mother gazed pensively ahead, and my thoughts kept returning to the girl from the inn and the unfamiliar world I had glimpsed through her. "When peasants' children grow up, do they become peasants too, mother?" I asked. "Yes." She lifted her eyebrows, surprised at the question. "Sons usually take over working their father's fields, although some become apprenticed to craftsmen to learn a trade." "Can they enter monasteries?" She thought for a moment. "They can become lay brothers, I suppose, but monks need to be able to read and write." "What about girls?" "They marry or remain with their parents to care for them." "Why?" "Because they do not have servants to do so, and besides," she added, anticipating my next question,
they cannot afford an endowment. But what if that is what they want?
I felt myself flush. It seems unfair. My mother smiled sadly.
Your indignation comes from the right place, daughter. The ability to answer God's calling should not depend on how rich one is. After all, Jesus asked the apostles to give up their possessions to follow him.
Her voice trailed off, and it was not until some years later that I understood her hesitation. There is a heated dispute within the church on the issue of the poverty of Christ, and whether monks and priests should imitate the simplicity of the first Christians or be free to enjoy worldly trappings, as many of them do. And because proponents of both approaches tend to accuse each other of heresy, my mother thought it prudent not to excite my young mind. She had been fond of telling me that I was quick, inquisitive, and, even at that age, unwilling to accept answers as givens, and I could see that that gave her satisfaction. She liked to tell the story of how, when I was 4, I had asked why God, if he was all-powerful, had not defeated Satan yet. And if he was the creator of all things, as the Holy Bible said, then had he created Satan too? And if he loved all of his creation, did not that mean that he should love Satan equally? My mother did not know how to answer those questions, but she was proud of me, even if that pride was bittersweet. When I had first asked for reading lessons, she was reluctant. Reading only makes you desire to know more and see more, but women's lives are destined to be lived within the confines of our worlds, whether domestic or monastic, she had told me, before relenting and teaching me to read anyway. Now she put her arm around me, and I reciprocated the gesture. From the moment she had realized that she was with child again, and that monastic life would be its destiny, she had prayed every day for me to be blessed with a vocation. She had heard of women and men cloistered against their heart's desire or their mind's inclination, and felt the injustice of it. That was why, even though she was gifting me to the church, she was determined to ensure that I would have the time to make the final decision on my own. But she hoped the vocation would come. She later wrote to me that riding through those poor hamlets, she saw enough reasons why a cloistered life was a better option. The world was harsh and dangerous, with the perpetual specter of famine and threat of violence, either from outlaws or from constant skirmishes among the empire's restless barons. And then there was Eve's lot, the brutal cycle that compelled a woman to give birth every year for as long as her body endured. She herself had brought 10 children into the world at a great cost in bodily suffering and anguish when 4 of them had died. Her only consolation on that journey was that I would be spared that fate and live out my life in relative security, protected from ignorance, privation, and violence by walls more respected than those of our house, even if it meant that we would never see each other again. The trees were casting lengthening shadows onto the high road when we reached the final stretch leading to Disibodenberg's gate. Bare fields lay on both sides of the tract, bordered by the forest to the south and vineyards to the north. About a mile ahead, at the confluence of the Glan and the Naya, the abbey sat atop Mount St. Disibod, thickly forested and gently sloping toward the rivers. A small town, walled by a wooden palisade, hugged its western foothill. A sleepy-looking watchman barely glanced at the abbot's letter before waving us through. We entered the main street lined with timber houses, with only a few, occupied by merchant families, as I learned later, a mix of timber and stone. The side streets were already dim, candlelight beginning to seep through the shuttered windows of their smaller, simpler abodes. Farther up was the market square, where sellers were taking down their stalls and shopkeepers boarding up their windows for the night. A few glanced curiously as we passed in front of the parish church and took the road that ascended toward the abbey. At the gate, my father dismounted and knocked on the iron-bound doors. A moment later, the porter opened the small grill. When he learned our business, he began to manipulate the heavy latch, and the doors squeaked on their hinges and opened wide.
"The abbot is awaiting you, my lord," the monk bowed. "Thank you, brother."
As we passed under the stone arch, I noticed my father taking stock of it with his soldier's eye. The gate was new and solid, but the abbey wall was no more than a wooden palisade, much like the one surrounding the town. Despite the deepening dusk, it was obvious that it was in serious need of repair, with some of its logs rotten at the bottom and streaked with lichen and weeds growing profusely in the cracks. He clucked his tongue softly and made a motion with his head that I immediately recognized. I could almost hear him think,
"The abbot must be a persuasive man to have enlisted the Count von Sponheim as a benefactor."
2 months earlier at Bermersheim, the Count had painted an intriguing picture of the Abbey of St. Disibod, where his daughter Jutta had founded her convent. Established more than 400 years before by a saint from Hibernia who had brought Christianity to the Rhineland, the abbey had once possessed an impressive library that attracted monks from as far as France eager to cultivate their minds. But a series of plunders by the Normans and the Hungarians had caused its fortunes to decline, and by the time the fourth Emperor Heinrich ascended the throne, the community had been reduced to fewer than 10 monks, and the buildings had fallen into such disrepair that the brothers considered abandoning the place altogether. The abbey continued its unremarkable existence until Abbot Kuno's election 5 years before, after which he set out to increase the number of brothers in residence and undertake extensive repair works. Although Count Stefan had at first thought of the Abbey of St. Eucharius in Trier as the most suitable place for Jutta, he was sufficiently impressed with Kuno's efforts to support her wish.
"I had no hesitation in giving my consent, and I am glad her endowment is contributing to the re-establishment of St. Disibod," he had told my father, before adding proudly, "In his letters, Abbot Kuno has praised her learning and piety."
The courtyard was dominated by a bulky church with small square windows through which dim light filtered onto the courtyard, where traces of snow melted between the flagstones. A pair of grooms carrying torches appeared from the stables. A moment later, a portly middle-aged monk came out from a building located along the northern wall. He made his way toward us at a surprisingly brisk pace, his black robes fluttering around the knotted belt girdling his prominent belly. He was followed by another monk, tall and thin, with a cowl pulled low over his face. The shorter one had graying hair around his tonsure and a jovial red face, which betrayed a weakness for food and perhaps drink, too. As soon as he was within earshot, he exclaimed cordially,
"Mein Herr Hildegard, I am Abbot Kuno, and it is an honor to welcome you to St. Disibod."
He pointed toward his companion, whose face emerged from under the hood to reveal a younger man with finely chiseled aristocratic features frozen into a haughty and forbidding expression.
"This is Prior Helenger. We trust you had a pleasant journey?"
My father bowed slightly before addressing his hosts.
"We set out early and rode most of the day, but God willed that we arrived safely and in good spirits, if a little tired." "I am sure of that," the abbot nodded as if the exhaustion of long journeys was something of which he had extensive experience. "I had our guest house prepared and a meal laid out for you. After you fortify yourself, you are welcome to join us at Vespers."
"Father Abbot, this is my daughter, Hildegard."
My father turned to me. Thus prompted, I curtsied, although under my cloak my heart was pounding against my ribs. But I lifted my chin, determined not to show the anxiety. The abbot smiled and put his hand on my head.
"God bless you, my child. We are happy that you are to join us on our spiritual journey, and we hope that it will be a fruitful one for you."
Emboldened, I returned his smile. But when I turned to Prior Helenger, I saw that his face had not lost its stony severity, but I held his gaze. 3. Abbey of St. Disibod, November 1115. Much later, in a letter she wrote me, my mother described those events I was not privy to on the following day. After breakfast, my parents and the abbot had a private meeting. Prior Helenger was also in attendance, standing behind Kuno's chair with his head bowed and arms folded inside the sleeves of his robe. My mother complimented the abbot on the simple yet satisfying fare in the refectory.
In recent years, we have received generous gifts of legacy that include fertile lands along the rivers, and we were blessed with a good harvest this year, he informed them proudly. I am pleased to hear that, my father cleared his throat.
Under pressure from my mother, he had come with a petition regarding the terms of my enclosure. It made him nervous, for he was instinctively deferential toward religious authority. Now he shifted from one leg to the other, struggling to find the right entry point to his business.
The abbey's reputation has grown greatly thanks to your wise management, and I am certain your successes will continue to attract generous benefactors.
The abbot inclined his head, visibly flattered.
And pious novices.
Indeed, my father nodded.
The one I can vouch for, my own daughter, is endowed with exceptional gifts of spirit, and we are honored that she will be joining Sister Yuta and the other women who have elected to lead most holy lives as anchorites.
At Bermersheim, Count Stefan had spoken proudly of Yuta's ascetic inclinations, which seemed only to have deepened at St. Disibod. Anchorites were the most devout men and women of God who chose to live in complete seclusion. They had food and water brought to them and refuse taken away, and that was usually the extent of their interaction with the world. My mother was not sure if I would find such a life to my liking. In the weeks since the Count's visit, she had worked tirelessly to persuade her husband to negotiate a delayed novitiate for me, to which he had finally, if begrudgingly, consented. Now, standing beside him, she despaired of his meandering.
We are pleased also, the abbot assured him graciously. Father abbot, my father resumed, prompted by a discreet nudge, Hildegard is only 11 years old.
Kuno lifted his abundant eyebrows.
We would ask that her novitiate be delayed until she is 16 years of age, so she can take her vows at 18.
My mother thought she had heard a gasp from Prior Helenger, who raised his head for the first time.
Our custom dictates that child oblates begin their novitiate at 14, the abbot protested. A custom is not an abiding rule, my father sounded almost apologetic.
It had been my mother's idea to write to the learned monks at Lorsch to find out exactly what Regula Benedicti said about the maximum age and duration of a novitiate. It said nothing.
We request that an exception be made because of Hildegard's age. It would be of great benefit if she were given more time to prepare for the consecrated life, so her vows might be all the more pleasing to God. This rule may not prescribe exactly when the novitiate should start. The pleased look faded from Kuno's face. But as abbot, I have discretion in the matter, and I see no reason to break with our tradition, especially as your daughter has already turned 10, the minimum age of acceptance into a monastic community set by the 10th Council of Toledo.
The prior nodded in haughty approval, and my mother turned to my father expectantly. But his face only said,
I have tried. There is nothing more I can do.
She made the decision in an instant.
With your permission, Father Abbot, as her parents, it is our wish that Hildegard should reach the age of reason before making such a commitment.
Then she added more forcefully,
We have come here on the recommendation of Count Stefan von Sponheim, who holds this abbey in high esteem. However, we can easily secure a place for our daughter at St. Eucharius, Hirschau, or the new Loch Priory that is fast developing a great reputation.
The prior's expression froze in shocked disbelief, but the abbot's face betrayed a shadow of worry that was enough for my mother to realize he needed my dowry.
A moment of tense silence followed as Kuno struggled with the decision. Abbeys preferred short oblatures because during that time the candidate could still change his or her mind and withdraw, rare though it was, and take their dowry with them. Once the novitiate began, a departure meant forfeiting the dowry.
"I will grant your request," he said finally.
"Father Abbot, are you sure?"
The prior's voice was almost a hiss.
"Hildegard belongs to the church. Why should she be given a choice? She is but a girl child."
"I made my decision, Brother Prior."
He cut him off with a gesture. Hellinger's lips twisted as if he had swallowed something bitter, but he fell silent.
"Can this provision be added to the dedication letter?" my father asked.
The abbot motioned to a scribe who had been sitting by the window and instructed him to add the relevant clause. The monk returned to his desk, and soon the document was ready for the seal and signatures. These steps completed, my father laid a heavy leather purse on the abbot's desk. Monastic endowments took various forms. Lands, quarries, or mines were commonly deeded to the religious house by parents or guardians. Others chose to pay money. The golden bezants in my father's purse were his reward for service in the Holy Land, and he was proud of it, for he considered freeing Jerusalem from the Saracen to have been his duty as a Christian. And now this treasure would uphold his family's standing and support the monks' holy work.
"We are honored that you have chosen our house as your daughter's spiritual refuge, and we will do everything in our power to ensure that her service bears fruit."
Abbot Kuno rolled up the parchment and handed it to Hellinger, who shot my father a look of contempt for allowing his woman to have so much say in family matters. My father bowed.
"That is our sincere wish also."
The abbot rose as the bells rang out for terce.
"I will send Brother Adam, our guest master, to show you around the abbey," he said, bidding them wait in his parlor.
A moment later, my parents watched the two monks cross the courtyard toward the church, the prior talking animatedly and the abbot shaking his head. When they were out of earshot, my father turned to my mother.
"Did you just give an ultimatum to the abbot of St. Disibod?"
He tried to sound severe, but the brazenness of it was almost entertaining.
"It was not something I relished, husband, but I had to make sure Hildegard was not enclosed for life while being little more than a babe, and the way your petitioning was going.
But what if he said no? You know very well we cannot afford any of the other places."
She impatiently swept her hand to encompass the abbey compound.
"Just look at this place. It may have an ambitious abbot at its helm, but it still needs a lot of work, and that requires funds. You saw the state of the guest house."
The walls of their quarters had not been whitewashed in a long time, and the door hinges squeaked atrociously. When the lights were out, she could swear she saw the sky through cracks in the roof beams.
"We are not offering a dowry that will make a significant difference."
In addition to the golden bezants, my father was gifting a bale of white silk for altar cloth and a reliquary containing a finger bone of St. Simeon, an early Christian martyr, also from Jerusalem.
"It is not as valuable as fertile land or a good acreage of forest with sturdy oaks."
"That may be, but the future of church lands is uncertain."
My mother dropped her voice, as many people did when mentioning the imperial conflict with the Pope.
"Any income counts to abbots like Kuno. I am sure that is what he was just explaining to the prior."
My father narrowed his eyes. He had not thought of it like that.
"Besides," she added, "it did not hurt to remind him that we are on friendly terms with Count Stefan, who is quite possibly his largest benefactor."
He nodded admiringly.
"If you were a man, you would make a fine diplomat," he said,
just as the door opened and Brother Adam, a pale-faced monk with a deferential manner, appeared and apologized for the wait. Outside, the sky was overcast again, threatening rain. All around, there were signs of a community in transition. New buildings, ongoing construction, and structures that were old and would have to be replaced. the much-mended palisade wall looked ancient at a time when stone was increasingly the choice of builders. But the church was new, its gray stone silhouette looming over the courtyard. The monk's cloister was attached to it on one side. The bulk of the church was finished, though work was still being done on the roof. Scaffolding surrounded the tower that crowned the structure at the point where the nave intersected the transept. They stopped outside so as not to disturb the monks who were singing terse, the mid-morning office, and Brother Adam explained that the church had replaced a wooden chapel that had become too small to accommodate the growing community.
"How long has it been under construction, brother?" my father asked.
The monk thought about it.
"Must be 9 years now. It was started by the previous abbot, but work proceeded slowly for lack of funds. It picked up after Abbot Kuno took over."
"Count Stefan von Sponheim speaks highly of his efforts."
"Our abbot knows many great lords in the Rhineland, and his dedication has inspired much generosity. In fact," Brother Adam added, "Sister Jutta's endowment contains a quarry downriver near Bingen, and the stone was used to finish the church."
My father shot my mother a glance that said,
"This is what a large dowry can pay for."
Meanwhile, a thin drizzle began to fall, and the guestmaster led them toward the smaller, unpaved courtyard on the southern side of the church. On one end stood a pair of thatch-roofed buildings, one of which faced a garden hemmed by shrubs that formed a natural hedge. Brother Adam said they were the infirmary and the medicine workshop, run by Brother Wigbert, the abbey physician. At the other end, the women's convent was nestled in a corner of the abbey. Unlike the infirmary, it was surrounded by a fence of simple logs tied together, tall enough to obscure the view of the inside. Consisting of two plain buildings of roughly hewn planks with small shuttered windows, it had a cheerless, makeshift look to it.
"This is where Sister Jutta and two others are living."
Their guide lowered his eyes decorously.
"They are the first women to have ever resided at St. Disibod."
The courtyard-facing house was the anchoress's daughter, he added, while the other was the chapel. My mother felt a lump in her throat as she took in the poor space that was to become my new home, which looked even more miserable in the rain. Having exhausted the subject, the monk was already turning back. Then he noticed my father examining the section of the abbey wall that ran from the convent to the kitchens behind the church. It was taller and thicker than elsewhere, and it had a disused-looking watchtower embedded in it.
"You may be wondering why this wall is so fortified, my lord," the monk said politely.
"Indeed, I am."
He peeked through the doorless opening into the watchtower. Despite its bigger size, the wall was in even poorer shape. Some of its beams were broken at the top, giving it a forlorn appearance.
"When St. Disibod, our holy founder, arrived here centuries ago to baptize the local Franks, he camped on this mountain with his followers. For years they were exposed to attacks from the pagan hordes that wanted to drive them away, so they built a wall around their abodes. What you are looking at is the oldest part of that wall. The rest was replaced in later times."
Then he added,
"It is Abbot Kuno's plan to replace the entire wall."
He raised his eyes piously to the sky.
"With God's help."
Behind his back, my mother rolled her eyes. The help the abbey needed was far more likely to come from novices' purses than any divine intervention. In the guest house, my mother fastened my golden hair under the veil. "This is a special day for you, my dove," she said. "From now on, your life will be spent in prayer and work. Do you understand that?"
"Yes, mother," I replied solemnly.
She walked around to face me and pulled a tiny wooden box from the pouch at her belt. "I want you to know that even though you have left your family home, you will never be far from our thoughts." Her face was serious, her eyes full of sadness. "And you from mine," I assured her eagerly, too excited to be sad just yet. She smiled briefly, but the smile did not reach her eyes. "You are so young,
and I fear that as time goes by you may start forgetting."
She paused to control the tremble in her voice, then lifted the box.
"That is why I am giving this to you, to keep with you always."
She opened the lid to reveal a small lump of salt, smooth and white, but of a whiteness that was almost translucent. It was shaped like a heart, though irregularly so, with one side slightly bigger than the other.
"Your father brought this for me from Alzoy the year you were born," she said. "I want you to have it, to remind you of home."
I took the box and examined the gift.
"I will always carry it with me," I said,
clasping my fingers around it. Then I looked up at my mother's face.
"Even when I go to the church?"
She dropped her gaze.
"Sweet child, you will not be going to the big church after today."
"Why not?"
"Because the anchoresses vowed to live in seclusion, and they do not leave the enclosure."
I frowned.
"Does that mean I won't be able to go into the forest to pick flowers either?"
"I am afraid not. The beauty of the world is not for anchoresses to enjoy."
I was confused and thought my mother must have been mistaken. Nonetheless, my next words surprised me.
"But I am not an anchoress yet. I am only an oblate, so I don't have to do everything the same way."
My mother opened her mouth, but no words came out. Afterward, I would sometimes wonder if she was loath to quash my hopes, or if the simple logic of what I had said prevented her from contradicting me. Or maybe it was something else entirely. She proceeded to secure my veil, and as she did so, she said softly, as if to herself,
"Let God sort this out, as he ultimately does all things."
But I could feel her hands trembling. The oblation ceremony took place during the evening office of Vespers, by which time the rain was falling steadily, at times lashing horizontally in the chilly wind. The lay brothers had lit candles in the nave and around the altar, but shadows lingered in the corners and under the low vaulted ceiling as the monks filed through the door from the cloister and took their seats in the stalls. From the front pew, my family and I listened to their voices soar to the rafters and echo off the walls. "Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat in principio et nunc et semper et in saecula saeculorum. Amen." After the first reading, a succession of four psalms followed. The music was so sweet, and the cadence of the Latin words so mesmerizing that my head began to swim. The blazing candles seemed haloed by scintillating stars that vanished and reappeared amidst the swirls of incense that rose heavily and dissipated into the corners of the church. It was exquisite, but also painful, and I had to close my eyes against the brightness. The weightless sensation I had sometimes experienced at Bermersheim returned, and I felt as if I were floating, supported and surrounded by light.
"As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew at the tax collector's booth, and he said to him, 'Follow me,' and he rose and followed."
The abbot's voice reached me. The monks intoned another psalm, and I approached the altar and knelt before the abbot, who laid both hands on my head.
"We beseech you, Lord God, to look upon your servant Hildegard, who embarks on her monastic journey with infinite love. We ask your Son to bestow his blessings, and the Holy Spirit to offer guidance as she labors on the path toward earthly perfection."
He turned to a novice who held a vessel of holy water and a lighted taper. He handed the candle to me and sprinkled the water on my head to the chant of Magnificat Anima Mea Dominum. After the monks filed back to the cloister, the abbot led us to the women's convent. The rain had stopped and the wind had died down. The convent's small windows, lighted by oil lamps, seemed almost welcoming. The door opened, and two anchoresses appeared on the threshold with folded arms, sisters Adelheid and Juliana, were no more than 20 years old and had the reticent air of those unaccustomed to seeing outsiders. Sister Yuta, in keeping with her adherence to the rule of seclusion, did not come out. I studied the women who were to become my companions, their heads covered by gray veils. They gazed back, their expressions serious and steady, though not unfriendly. They wore gray robes of coarse wool without so much as a hemp cord around the waist, and they stood barefoot.
"Holy sisters," the abbot addressed the anchoresses, "I have brought Hildegard of Bermersheim to share your simple abode. I ask you to impart your wisdom on her and provide her with spiritual guidance as she prepares for the consecrated life."
The women bowed their heads, and Sister Adelheid extended her hand. I glanced at my parents, blinking away a sudden sting of tears. But I knew my duty and took the proffered hand, stepping into the dimness of the enclosure. The door closed behind me, and everything was silent as night fell on the abbey. This, too, my mother related to me later in her letter. Early the next morning, they assembled outside the church under a gray sky. The gravestones in the monks' cemetery were still wet from the rain, but the air was dry, and a cold wind blew from the north. From time to time, my mother glanced toward the enclosure until my father noticed her brooding aspect.
"I am impressed by the work Abbot Kuno has done here," he tried to lift her spirits. "I reckon the abbey's best days are still ahead."
"It will take a long time." She did not even bother to hide the bitterness in her voice.
"Physical decay is not nearly as bad as a spiritual one."
The previous night at supper, the abbot had complained about the lax rules, corruption, and lack of discipline found in so many monasteries that a group of French Benedictines decided to leave their house at Molema and establish a new foundation at Citeaux, dedicated to serving God with simplicity, modesty, and rigor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.